हेलो एवरीवन, नमस्कार आप सभी को। मैं निधि मिश्रा आप सभी का स्वागत करती हूँ जो अमित सिन्हा आईएएस एकेडमी विच इज़ एन ऑनलाइन इनिशिएटिव। सो आई एम हियर अगेन विथ येट अनदर टॉपिक विच इज़ बिकॉज ऑफ यू नो वी नीड टू यूटिलाइज दिस लॉकडाउन पीरियड एंड वी आर कन्वर्टिंग इट इनटू एन अपॉर्चुनिटी। सो एज यू मस्ट हैव बीन वॉचिंग थ्रू वेरियस mass media and other print media that a wise person is one who actually develops one capability into a crisis situation which is going to you know bear the fruit whenever the period or the situation normalizes. So with this thought, let's begin our another topic, and it is in continuation of my last two lectures which I have based it on NCERT book. And as you all remember, I hope that we have already discussed caste, its features, its present situation, the changing dimension, and we have also discussed tribe, its way, its understanding in mainstream society, and how they have been affected by the economic development and the developmental goal of the of your nation. So it is yet another topic which we are doing today, which is in continuation with that only. And why we are discussing caste, tribe, and today as family and kinship, because this is the primary chapter, this is the basic unit of your society on which the various social relationships are blooming and developing, right? So let's begin. So today we are going to do family and kinship. Since it is written family first, even in your NCERT book it is written family first, but I would like to start here with kinship first. Why? Because kinship actually provides you a framework for your social and cultural life. You know, our family is based on kin group. So it is basically, we need to clear our understanding about the kinship, that what is kinship. Famous sociologist G. Duncan Mitchell, you know, says that families or kinship groups are one which are defined through relatedness, which is based on birth and marriage. That is on the relationships of this is called as consanguine relation, you know, which is based on birth. It is actually a blood relation. And another relationship which is built up, another kind of kinship which actually grows, is based on marriage, which is called as affinal. So we have in kinship, we have two bonds. One is consanguine bond, which is blood relationship, and another is affinal bond, which is based on your marriage, which is based on your ties, which is based on your conjugal relationship. Okay. Now, for kinship, you know, we have varied terminologies which is being used in kinship. We will not go into depth with, because it is not needed for us. Okay, we just need to have a primary understanding that how kinship leads to family organization and what are the changes which is taking place in present Indian society. So when I say that it is related to relatedness, in kinship also we see a various yet another dimension which is based on your joking relationship and avoidance. Certain kinship, which is actually I would say that it is based on affinal relationship, that it is established, it is based on joking relationship. In certain relationships there are actually dimension, the affection, or you say the another essence of that relationship is based on, or the relatedness is based on, a kind of joking relationship, a kind of lightness in the relationship. For example, we say that relationship between Devar and Bhabhi, Jija and Sali. So such kind of relationships are actually marked by joking relationship. But on the contrast of it, there is another kind of relationship which is avoidance. It is based on your affinal relationship, that you actually maintain a distance, you know, with certain relation, with certain family members of your family. For example, a kind of distance is maintained by the bride from her husband's elder brother, right, or from father-in-law. So this kind of social distances are maintained. Now I would just go into the essence of it, you know, being a feminist, being a sociology teacher, being a scholar, I would like to bring here another point, that why such kind of relationships are based. I would just see, and various your research paper also see such kind of social dimensions, that is, it actually establishes the patriarchal norms, the mindset, the authority of one person, and also it strengthens your cultural and social norm of your family. One would also say that it leads to solidarity, and it also, and you actually, you know, give yourself to one's authority. That's all right, but it actually it shows the perseverance, it shows the continuation of one's authority in a family, right? So that is what is my understanding, and that is what the understanding of various sociologists and essence of various research papers. Okay, now as the affinal relationship are based on marriages, okay, so there are two kinds of marriage, or there are various kinds of marriages, but it is primarily, we see it as endogamous or exogamous, right? So when I say endogamous, that is endogamy, that you are marrying, for example, caste. Caste has a feature of endogamy. You do not prefer intercaste marriage, right? So this is a practice of endogamy. You are marrying within your community. You are marrying within your, it shows its relatedness, okay? Exogamy, that you marry outside your community. You marry outside your village, right? So on the basis of marriage, when I say, a kind of relationship is established, a kind of kinship is established. So this also shows a kind of developing relationship, okay, which is based on relatedness and also extension. When you practice endogamy, you are actually marrying within your own community, which actually strengthens your caste hierarchy, right? But when you marry, when you follow exogamy, for example, village exogamy, you know, people from same village, they do not prefer to marry within the same village. They look for distant places, they look for distant villages where they marry their daughter or their son. So this is a kind of village exogamy. Now, what is the purpose? The purpose, the essence behind it was to extend your social relationship, to extend your kin group, to extend your kinship. So this was the essence on which the family is situated, on which the family is based. Now, through family, we will try to understand that how the various social relationships are actually, or the kinship relationship, are actually transforming or changing, and what are the subtle changes which we are experiencing today. Okay, now let's come to, so here from kinship we move to family, right? Why I first started kinship? Because kinship is the base which actually provides a framework for your social and cultural relationships, for your social life, for your social relationships. Now family, here, instead of, you know, immediately going into what is family, what are the functions of family, what are the structures of family, I would first, you know, just start with a, on a very, what you say, informal kind of discussion. That the moment family word strikes into your mind, you know, you feel as if, okay, for one person it is a kind of support, it is a kind of a strength, right? That you cannot imagine yourself without your family. But on the other hand, you know, for some, family would be a kind of, you know, hindrance in pursuing one's aspiration. Ask a girl, in fact, a girl from a forward caste, in fact, a girl from a sound socially and economically background girl whose mobility is restricted most of the time, that how she actually pursues her aspiration. So for some, the family maybe would be a platform for actually fulfilling your aspiration, for actually, you know, extending all your dreams which actually you have seen for yourself. But for some, it may have been an obstruction, it may have been a hurdle, you know. So anyways, with that, you know, we understand family, that family on a very primary note, or family on a very a basic understanding, that a family is a group of people which is based on kinship, which is based on kin group relations. Again, I would say that family, which is based on either consanguine or on affinal relationship. So when I say family, which is a combination of both affinal and consanguine. It is a group of family members. It is a group of kin members, which actually shows continuity, integration, and development of social life. Continuity, bringing up of new children, bringing up of new members in the family. Integration, it builds a solidarity. It gives you support. It actually links to the various social institutions of the society. And development, that the very essence, the very function of family changes according to the changing social, political, and economic structures of the society. Right? So with that, let's understand that we will focus here that what are the functions of family, what is the structure of family, and how the family per se is changing over the period of time. How we see today family in a post-globalized world, how we see today our family in the in COVID-19 crisis period, right? How we see family from the perspective of a woman, right? So that we will try to understand, because mugging up that this kind of family, a nuclear family, an extended family, these all, you know, you can mug up anywhere, but this is not going to land you up anywhere. Even your competitive exams, it asks about the essence, that how the family and its roles are changing, right? So let's understand first that when we understand family as a family per se, we understand in it is it's in two it's a structure, and the structure is, first we see family as a social institution. As a social institution itself. When I say social institution, that means we have certain social, cultural norms and beliefs which are inherent in the system, which are inherent in the institution, right? Which are written, which are orally also continuing, right? And another, when I say that family, we understand its relatedness with the various other social institutions of the society. That how family is associated with your political institution, how family is associated with economic institution. Have you ever wondered that how family can be an economic institution? But that also we'll discuss here. And how a family, as other cultural institutions, how family is related to education as a social institution. So with these two broader structural categorization, we understand. First, you need to understand that empirically, family and types of family varies from community to community and society to society. But in an essence, in analytical form, family is universal, right? It is the basis of all community. It is the basis of your social life. You cannot imagine your social life without a family, right? So, when I say that family as a social institution, an institution within, then I identify family as joint family, family as nuclear family, family as an extended family, family as a single parent family, because we are also discussing the present day, right? And family as family made by same-sex family. Why I have, you know, made it under bracket, that still it is developing in our society. It is still not well accepted in our society, right? Though there have been movies, recently, but on the same-sex marriage, you know, but still it is not widely accepted. Okay, so let's understand joint family. Famous sociologist, Iravati Karve has defined family as a group of people who actually reside under, who have a same household, who reside under same roof. They have a same hearth, they have a same chulha unka same hota hai, aur ek authority ke andar wo abide karte hain, they follow one authority, right? So these are the features which actually famous sociologist Iravati Karve identifies the features of joint family. Okay, now when I say joint family, so joint family has been a basic traditional ethos of Indian society. And when I say joint family, the joint family, don't take it as just simple two English word, joint family. Rather, it has a larger understanding. You know, we today you know, India is largely identified by joint family, and we are also moving towards, you know, nuclear family. But we have yet another understanding of joint family. We may not be joint in its literal term. We may not be staying together in literal sense. We may not be under the same roof, but the essence is intact. The essence of joint family is intact even in present time in India, right? So don't take it as the two simple word joint and family. Understand it in a wider aspect. When I say joint family, there are certain features of joint family which you need to understand, that what are the features which actually gives specificity to the meaning of joint family in India. So joint family is actually identified on filial devotion of sons. You know, your association of sons, I'm saying, quote unquote, association and relatedness of sons towards their family, towards their family relationships, towards their kin member, kin groups, okay? Another, readiness of economic support. See, I'm saying that filial devotion of sons, that sons actually take the responsibility for taking care of their family under one authority, right? And I say, when I say filial devotion of son, that means that the sons, the primary soul earning member may be, the sons would be at any cost, their family would come first, then only their other aspirations, their other dreams, their other any factors would actually affect them. But family would come first to them. So the filial devotion of sons. Second is readiness of economic support. That whatever may be, what may come and what may go, you know, the sons will support the family economically. Right? Here also there is a devotion. Even, you know, some, maybe if a family, if there is a joint family where many generations or two generations are staying or three generations are staying together, let's say two generations are staying together, in that there may be, you know, two, three sons staying together. Maybe one son would be quite economically affluent or quite capable enough to support his family, but maybe the other two sons may not be economically so strong enough. So the eldest son has to devote itself to the family and has to support the other two sons, the other two brothers of the family, even if they are not so economically capable, right? So that is what is readiness of economic support, right? Third is lack of state organized system for old ones. See, there has been we all accepted that the public institutions, the public setup, the public there have been less support from the government for the older ones. Same as I would say that there have been less public support in terms of social institutions for mothers in the form of daycare or creche. Right. So in the same spirit, there has been less organized system, or you can say that there has been less public support system for looking after the old ones. So the joint family actually provides support in all the sense, culturally, socially, economically, to its older ones, to its older family members. Okay. Now when I say that because of this lack of organized public system, so joint family was seen as a substitute for looking after the old members of the family instead of being looked after by any public institution, right? Public institution, old age home, jisko hum bahut hi yahan pe apne yahan we see it in a very नेगेटिव एंड डेरोगेटरी टर्म. अपने बेटे को, अपने बच्चे को, अपने माँ बाप, बच्चे ने अपने माँ बाप को ओल्ड एज में डाल दिया, राइट? सो दिस अंडरस्टैंडिंग, राइट, द योर ओपननेस इज समवेयर लैकिंग. एनीवेज, सेकंड इज लैंड एज मटेरियल इंसेंटिव. द बेसिक पर्पस ऑफ जॉइंट फैमिली वॉज दैट लैंड हैज, सी द लैंड इज वन प्रॉपर्टी, the land is as a capital which actually supports the family, which actually sustains the family, right? So land, when you have a joint family of living, obviously the land as a property is not fragmented. The land as a property is not divided into many sons, right? On the other hand, when you have a fragmented family, when you have a nuclear family, maybe one son or the younger son would demand that even I have a right on my ancestral property. So I want my own right. So let's divide the land. So let's do the separation, right? So that would lead to fragmentation of land as a capital. So in order to, you know, in order to stop fragmentation of land as capital, the joint family was one, you can say one support or one idea which actually supported land as a material incentive for the family. Right, so this was actually the features of joint family. Right, now let's come to, since we all understand, we all know that the essence of Indian family is joint family, but over the period of time, with the policy of globalization and liberalization, with the policy of modernization and urbanization, with the essence or with the policy of migration, on various policies of migration, we see that there have been mass migration from one state to another state, or from one area to another area, or from village to urban areas. That has actually landed up to or led to nuclear family. Kaise aaya nuclear family? क्या हुआ कि जब हमारे यहाँ अर्बनाइजेशन का प्रोसेस शुरू होता है और कहीं ना कहीं हमें जो है अर्बनाइजेशन एज अ प्रोसेस विलेज को भी अफेक्ट करना शुरू करता है थ्रू वेरियस मास मीडिया, थ्रू न्यूज़पेपर, टीवी चैनल्स. तो ये इफेक्ट करता है हमारे ग्रामीण क्षेत्र को भी, गांव के लोगों को भी. वो कहीं ना कहीं अपने एस्पिरेशंस को आगे बढ़ते देखते हैं इन टर्म्स ऑफ यू नो मूविंग टुवर्ड्स अर्बन एरिया. बाय मूविंग टुवर्ड्स अर्बन एरिया, उनको लगता है कि वो कुछ ज़्यादा कमा सकते हैं अर्बन एरियाज में जाके, क्योंकि अब रूरल एरियाज में भी चीज़ें जो हैं विद द एडवेंट ऑफ अर्बनाइजेशन, विद द इनिशिएशन ऑफ अर्बनाइजेशन, थिंग्स वर चेंजिंग. यू नो द पैट्रोनेज, the basic essence of patronage was also changing. Land reform movements हुए, land reform measures लिए गए, वो may be partially थे और it was not in full flown or full effort taken by the government or whatever were the lacunas, but land reform measures have actually brought many changes in the social life of rural people, which also led to migration of people, rural people, from their village to urban areas, which